first speaker that I would like to introduce is Yuri Van Geest. Aangenaam, Yuri. And Yuri is the author of a book called The Exponential Organization, which has been translated in 17 languages, and that has clearly influenced a lot of ministers, prime ministers, and board members in terms of their thinking process. He's also the founder of the Singularity University in the Netherlands. And going on the website of this university, let me read a few words that describe what is the purpose of the university. Its mission is to educate, inspire, and empower leaders to apply exponential technologies to address humanity's grand challenges. So on that note, Yuri, welcome on stage.
Thank you. All right, no slides, just me. Who knows about exponential organizations? Show of hands. Okay, only a few, okay. Three people. Who knows about Singularity University before this introduction? Okay, only a few, okay. All right, I have 35, 40 minutes, small Q&A. I'm gonna talk about three things. First, the latest exponential technologies. Second, Exponential Organizations, my book, briefly. And finally, about China, what's happening in China, and why I believe China will be number one, or where he is, globally, in terms of technology and innovation. So let's start quickly. Exponential technologies. All right, so I've been involved in this space for more than 10 years, even before Singularity University, and the pace of change is accelerating, especially the last 18 months. I'll explain to you later. So we used to live in a linear world, right? Linear growth, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We all know that. That changed, let's say, 10 years ago to exponential. Exponential technologies. That means they double in capacity every 18 months or even faster. That means the cost dropped by half every 18 months. For technologies like biotech, nanotech, neurotech, AI, robots, drones, 3D printing, 4D printing, solar energy, blockchain. All these technologies are conducive to Moore's law, the doubling of IT capacity every 18 months. So we move from linear to exponential. And today I'll explain why exponential is also outdated. We move from linear to exponential to quantum. Okay, let's talk about quantum computing. Who knows about quantum computing? Okay, only a few. All right, this is now not so new. It was invented by David Deutsch, the University of Oxford, in theory 30 years ago. It started 12 years ago in the US, in China, in Canada. But now it becomes important. A quantum computer is a parallel computer. We used to have a laptop or PC or smartphone, right? That's a sequential, step-by-step computer using bits, zeros and ones, sequentially. Now imagine you have a quantum computer that's a parallel computer using qubits. It can process zeros and ones at the same time, using superposition. So it can compute way faster than our classic linear computers. And 18 months ago, D-Wave Systems in the US and Canada announced a quantum computer 100 million times faster than a classic computer. Can be used for optimization problems. That means finance, your businesses, right? That's already outdated, because today they have a new quantum computer using 4,000 qubits, quantum bits, that has the computational power of all computers combined on Earth in one device, the size of this space over here. And that's also outdated, because in China, they're already a year ahead, at least, using a different quantum computer in Wuxi near Shanghai, using special light to manipulate the spin of the quantum computer, also has the computational power of all computers combined on Earth. And today in Nature, you can check it out for yourself, was a new development. We can create quantum computers at room temperature. It's a big deal. Using light chips, you can check it out today, it was launched today. We can speed up the computational power at least 10x relative to the previous quantum computer. So we move into a world of not 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128 exponential. We move to a world of 1, 2, 3, 1,000, 10 billion, 10 to the power 23, and even faster. That's quantum. That means like not this or this exponential, but this. We are at the cusp of living like this, vertical living. Okay, why is this important? Imagine we are able to do new innovations and discoveries in space exploration, climate research and solutions, most importantly, biomedical breakthroughs in the next few years because of quantum computing and artificial intelligence. Last year, a problem used to take 30,000 years to analyze. Today, it's 1 hour. Next year, 1 millisecond. That's the power of quantum computing. The next quantum computer will have the computational power of the universe. And the next one, parallel universes. It sounds like science fiction, but it isn't. It's real, and it's happening. In China, number one, and Canada, US. So that's the hardware layer of the future, so to speak. And then you have the operating system of the future, or now basically the present. That's the blockchain. Who knows about blockchain? Probably most of you. Blockchain, yeah, okay. It's like a trust, automated trust system using the internet. Millions of computers and nodes, right? It's the platform below Bitcoin. It's a public ledger, an open accounting system. You can log all transactions open and transparently. The Bitcoin blockchain is very popular right now, but it's outdated, and the same applies to Ethereum. Why? They are not secure enough. And this will be shown in the next few months. There will be new hacks, and it will implode, including Bitcoin, the price. The future of blockchain will be this, in my conviction. IPFS for storage, Jaku for the payment engine, and Ripple. And the reason is because it's the most secure system and it's able to defend the blockchain against the computational power of the advanced quantum computers that are already available today in the US, Canada, and most importantly in China, right? Because the quantum computer is able to decrypt or decode the encryption of the blockchain. That's the key secret, of course, but it's already happening. So IPFS becomes the new standard. It's able to withstand the pressure of quantum computing. Keep that in mind. Why is the blockchain important? One example, who knows about Abra, a startup, a fintech startup, as talked about earlier, rightly so. It's basically a blockchain-based startup, but okay, even beyond fintech, if fintech is outdated, blockchain-based startups are key. Because cheaper, more efficient, more effective, more secure, etc. Abra is like Western Union. We all know about Western Union, right? Western Union for remittances, you pay 30% of commission, right? Outdated. We don't want that, right? At least as a human being, right? Or citizen, or customer. Now we have Abra, like Western Union, using the blockchain, and it's 99% cheaper than Western Union. Blockchain-based, wallet-to-wallet, you can send euros to, let's say dollars, seamlessly. 99% cheaper. Even 90% cheaper than TransferWise, which is a fintech startup for remittances. To send money abroad, right? Okay, that's the impact of blockchain. Abra. A-B-R-A. That's the operating system of the new world. And then, just like your smartphone, you have hardware, operating system, and applications. The applications of the future are called artificial intelligence, algorithms, machine and deep learning. knows about deep learning? Probably most of you. Yeah, half of you. Okay. I've been involved with deep learning for now 6 years. It's phenomenal. It's the most advanced form of artificial intelligence. And artificial intelligence is like self-learning software looking for patterns in data all by itself without any human input or intervention. Okay? So computers today can listen and see, translate, and interpret better than the average human being. And they double in capacity every 9 months or even faster. Okay? Let me share the latest insights. Today, artificial intelligence is able to synthesize the interpretation of text, sound, and images, like us, like our consciousness or our brain or intelligence. 6 years ago, deep learning, the most advanced form of AI, could only analyze data and create 6 layers of reality in a hierarchy, like we are doing as a neural net, our brain, right, as a kid. A pixel, letter A, the apple, a sentence, paragraph, right, chapter, and a book. Self-organization using hierarchies. Today, anyone, 6 years later, how many levels of hierarchy about reality can AI create? It was six years ago. Now it's 150 layers, at least. So that means AI is much more impactful already, capable, than any human being, even Einstein. That means AI predicts, prevents problems, personalizes better than any human being can do today. Not in all cases, but in, let's say, in standard cases. No, it's not good at anomalies, right? Exceptions, yet. But here comes it. Last year was a key announcement. Maybe you heard about this, AlphaGo. Who heard about this? AlphaGo, DeepMind. The best player of Go in the world is now a piece of software, DeepMind by Google Alphabet, artificial intelligence. The best player of Go is now software beating the best human player of Go, right, a year ago. And what happened there is that the self-learning software, the AI software by DeepMind, Google, was playing against itself millions and millions of times and moved beyond the realm of understanding by any human or the best human player. It created intuitive decision-making. So artificial intelligence or algorithms have moved from analysis, diagnostics, to creative AI. Heck, AI today can create music, poetry, paintings like Rembrandt's, film scripts, all by itself, no human input or intervention. Analysis to creative to intuitive decision-making. So artificial intelligence in your business, insurance, banking, what have you, investment, will be fundamental going forward. Impact on employment will be 80% of current jobs will be impacted by technology, mostly artificial intelligence. 30% of current jobs will be totally disrupted, replaced by technology. Are you working in, let's say, parts of finance, retail, transportation, self-driving cars and trucks, education, healthcare, parts of it, construction and industry, you are in trouble. There's full disruption going on there in terms of jobs in the next 10 years. 50% of current jobs will be impacted by technology. That means your job will be impacted by algorithms. You have to dance with the machine. Man plus machine leads to the best results in most cases, in most jobs, in most tasks. Welcome to a new world. An example of artificial intelligence, who has heard about the company's fintech startup called Lemonade? Anyone? Show of hands. Lemonade is based in New York. It's an insurance company, fintech, peer-to-peer, AI-based, no more expensive real estate, no more expensive employees, just mostly using AI and some employees. It's for home insurance. It only exists for 1 year, imagine. How it works is like this. I have a smartphone app, Lemonade. I have a calamity in my home. let's say a fire or a theft or whatever, right? I open the app on my smartphone, I speak inside of it, this and this happened. In 6 seconds, they can determine if you are lying or not, looking at facial coding, the facial expressions, the blood pressure, and different signals, are you sweating or not, whatever, and soon also the intonation of your voice, to determine if you lie or not. They know it in 6 seconds, and that means they pay you out in 3 minutes. This is happening today. Talking about a real customer experience, right? Bye-bye classic, let's say, insurance companies. They operate 50 times cheaper than a classic insurance company. That's why Allianz in Germany invested big time in Lemonade. That's smart, right? Just disrupt or be disrupted. Disrupt yourself or somebody else will. You have to kill your own darlings, whatever you're going to do. If you don't, you are in trouble. You are vulnerable. Not today, but in the next 5 to 10 years. Because of these startups like Abra and Lemonade, etc., right? Okay, gotcha. And guess what? In China, they already have quantum artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence software customized for the quantum computer. That means in China, they are able to create today, as we speak down here, or let's say on this planet, 50 billion new materials. We talked about sustainability, rightly so, it's the biggest issue, climate change. It's likely that China will be the leader to help solve climate change this year. Why? Out of those 50 billion new materials using quantum artificial intelligence and nanotechnology to manipulate atoms and molecules from the ground up to create new smart materials, we are able to capture CO2 more effectively, globally, at scale, cost efficiently. That's the power of quantum AI and nanotech combined. Better than olefine, which used to be a substitute to capture CO2 in the last 12 years, but it didn't scale. Okay. Finally, exponential technology. Then I move to my book, Exponential Organizations. Who knows about Xi Nanophotonics? Okay, it's a new startup. It's basically focusing on quantum biology and nanophotonics and biophotonics. Now, skip those words. It's about light. Light will be the biggest revolution in the next 5 years, besides AI and quantum computing and blockchain. Light. Light is a wave and a particle. We can detect and manipulate light at the nanoscale as a particle, right? In a new way. That's important. Why? Everybody in this room emits light from their hand and around their face. We used to call that Reiki or auras, like esoteric or not scientific enough, right? Now it's scientific. I can measure your light from your hand, unique light, and determine your vitality and health state. That's one. Two, you can open doors using the unique light of your hand from a distance for security purposes, including banks, right? The light is important because light is information. We can use the light of the sunlight, without solar panels to create electricity today using solar nano coatings, like small layers on top of any, let's say, window or physical good. That's cheaper, ladies and gentlemen, than solar energy. Solar energy today is $2.50 per kilowatt hour. It's already 3 to 4 times cheaper than fossil fuels. And solar nano coatings are disrupting solar nano panels, solar energy panels. The coatings are cheaper. So in 10, 12 years, we will have a full renewable energy world. It's not science fiction, not 30 years like Shell is saying, or ExxonMobil because of self-interests. Only 12 years. Why? It's exponential. So 2% install base, 4%, 8%, it's doubling every 22 months, or even faster, in cost drop and production scale. All right, that's a big geopolitical change, I would say, right? Russia, Middle East, etc. We move from scarcity to abundance, not in all fields, but most fields, including energy. And if you solve energy, including Africa, you will solve water scarcity, you will solve health issues, also parts of the food system. That means education, development, off you go. That's a big deal. This will all play out in the next 20 years, 30 max, probably 20. Decentralization of almost everything, democratization of almost everything. The blockchain is enabling this, distributed system, trust system. You can make anything you want, you can imagine, as a user or citizen going forward. Not today, but long term. All right, gotcha. A little bit of mind-blowing, maybe. What are the implications for organizations? If you move from a linear to an exponential to a quantum world, how can you keep up? That's the core thesis of the book. We worked on the book for 2.5 years. Salim Ismail and me mostly, with help by Michiel Schuurman, my partner, Mike Malone, and Peter Diamandis, also co-founder of Singularity University. And the book has been well received, I think because we were the first ones to look at organizations from the point of view of exponential technologies. What is the impact of deep learning and AI on organizations, for example? Imagine it 5 years ago. And today, we know that AI is important, right? Algorithms. Why? 20 years ago, it was online first. You probably remember that. 10 years ago, mobile first. Today, it's AI first. If you start an innovation or startup or organization, if you don't start with AI first, the possibility space of AI, and the rest is secondary, the hardware part, the atoms, the genes, whatever, or the organizational processes or inputs, you are not taken seriously in China, in Wuxi, in Shenzhen, in Beijing, and also in Silicon Valley. It's AI first. Okay. Some statistics about organizations. The lifespan of cycle of a large organization has dropped from 70 years, 100 years ago, to 12 years today. Source, Yale University. It's speeding up. The half-life of a business competency has dropped from 30 years ago to 5 years today. That knowledge in terms of HR, marketing, sales, service, whatever, or finance even, right? If you work in IT, your half-life of your knowledge is only 2 years. 2 years. If you don't do anything, let's say for 4 years, you're basically done in terms of market value, labor market. As an exaggeration a little bit, but okay, you get my point. The time it takes to become a billion-dollar company has dropped from 20 years ago on average to 9 months today. Slack was a billion-dollar company in only 9 months. How can organizations scale so rapidly? What's going on here? Why are exponential organizations, EXOs, emerging today, including finance and insurance like Abra and Lemonade? First reason, based on the book Abundance by Peter Diamandis 5 years ago, let's say all of us, 100,000 years ago, we walk around together, we see an apple tree. Apples are scarce. We create a technology called a ladder. Apples are abundant. So, particular technologies are ways to transform scarcity into a particular abundance. That makes sense. Why? This is an abundance of information and communication. Used to be scarce, right? We have massive open online courses, almost 1 million globally. There's an abundance of education today. We have an abundance of energy in the next 10, 12 years. Okay, I get it. What's the point for organizations? The point is this. My background is in business economics. I've been trained to manage scarcity. If something is scarce, talents and resources, as an organization, you have to own it for competitive advantage. But if something is abundant, talents and resources, we have almost 4 billion people online, abundance of talents for your organization, abundance of talents and resources means access is sufficient for competitive advantage. Welcome to the sharing economy. It's a fundamental shift, not a hype. Scarcity is ownership, abundance is access. That means a totally new organization, an exponential organization, a smaller core team of full-time employees, and a larger circles of flexible workforce, staff on demand, using online marketplaces, larger section of community and crowdsourcing to get input employees or work, task, jobs, innovation from the outside in. You flip the organization inside out. Less ownership, more access. Okay. That's argument number one. Argument number two. We've learned to scale systems and technology as a key one building block of organizations. As we all know, an organization that is comprised of organizational structures, cultures, KPIs, employees, processes, strategies, the whole stack, right? So we've moved from scaling technology to scaling the whole organization. How can we make structures and cultures and KPIs exponential, conducive to this new quantum world? That's the characteristic of exponential organizations. Who's using a mobile phone of 15 years ago in this audience to survive in today's quantum world? Anyone? Show of hands? No. Maybe as a backup, right? For your battery. Smart, like an old Nokia. But why do you use an organizational model of 150 years ago to survive in today's quantum world? That means a classic linear industrial organization, hierarchical, top-down, centralized, closed secret system, focusing on ownership, linear, sequential, slow product development using waterfall and Prince 2, right? But most importantly, focusing on scalable efficiency instead of scalable learning and unlearning. Why are we doing this? It was great for a stable or predictable environment, not for a quantum-based world. Finally, our kids, I have two kids myself, millennials and Generation Z, below that, they have a different value system, right? For my generation, work is status plus income plus a lease car, right? As a joke, of course, but you get the picture. For our kids, millennials, work is life, is art, is self-expression, is purpose above all, meaning, contributing to a better world. They are more spiritual than my generation, yeah, and on average. Yeah. They are more flexible. They think inside out, not outside in. Why? If you grow up with gaming and the internet, and those are quite big, right, in their youth, what is the impact? You become the master of your own destiny and universe. You think and act inside out, not outside in. You move to a corporate, probably also in Luxembourg, or even worse, a governmental institution. What happens? Culture clash. Culture clash. Why? As a value clash. They want to innovate and contribute and be flexible from day one. But they are not allowed to. They believe in self-organization. They believe in teams because of World of Warcraft, right? And Minecraft and all these things, all these games. And they don't have the space and time to make it work from day one. So they leave to a startup or freelancer, or they emigrate, or all combined, including Holland, and probably most of Europe, even though we're on the right path right now, as said before. Long live France, of course. Great. We have to become a startup continent, right? Yeah, not a startup nation. Okay, so these millennials require a new kind of organization. So what is an exponential organization? Exponential organizations are at least 10 times more efficient, effective, and or faster than a classic linear organization in the same vertical market, using different exponential technologies, like quantum computing, blockchain, artificial intelligence, sensors, nanotech, what have you, right? plus new organizational techniques, new structures, new cultures, like APIs. Examples, not just Uber or Airbnb or Netflix or Amazon, Zappos or Slack or Lemonade or Abra. This is happening in all vertical markets, even very traditional markets like mining, construction. Disruption is happening even in atom-based, hardware-based vertical markets, even in food, in automotive. Tesla is an app on wheels. An app on wheels. There's an update every 1 or 2 weeks, right? Of the firmware. Every company increasingly becomes a software company. Software is eating the world. A quote by Mark Andreessen 6 years ago, that's outdated because now software is being eaten by artificial intelligence, and that's also outdated because classic artificial intelligence is being eaten by quantum artificial intelligence, as I explained before, that's faster. Today, AI is creating better AI all by itself, playing against itself. As a result of AI creating better AI without any human input or intervention, we have robots creating robots in China today without any human input or intervention. Foxconn, SoftBank, and Toyota combined. 70% operational. And we have nanotech creating better nanotech, creating newer and smarter materials. We talked about this earlier. Okay, gotcha. Some characteristics of exponential organizations. The most important item is they want to create a better world. Shareholder value, yes. More importantly, we want to create a better world. Sustainability, technological unemployment, wellness, healthcare, what have you, right? And Lemonade, I talked about this earlier, they give 20% of their profit away to purposes, the massive transformative purpose of their, yeah, let's say, of their clients. The clients can determine where they invest their money. What is the purpose, the better goal to improve the world? Wow. That's quite different from a classic bank or insurance company, right? If you have a purpose, you also have business benefits, right? Why? You have the power of pull effect instead of push. The best employees, partners, and customers come to you because you have a higher goal to improve the world. That means you move from managing to mobilizing. That means you have lower transaction costs, search costs, and you have better retention and loyalty. Both create business benefits. They also use AI algorithms in all their business departments, internally and externally. Algorithms for marketing, in sales, in service, in HR, in finance, in innovation itself, all departments. We move to algorithmic organizations, not fully, but increasingly. And guess what? Humans are best at being human. So the small space of our unique human capabilities relative to technology become more fundamental. That means organizations become more technological on the one hand, but at the same time, they become more human in terms of allowing employees to innovate from day one, decentralized authority to make decisions, team-based decision-making, less bureaucracy, less middle management, right? Purpose-driven organizations feeling better about their work, about their life. That's more human. An organization or a company without a purpose or community is just arbitrage, a commodity. It can be easily copied, but you cannot easily copy an authentic purpose shared across all employees from the heart and soul, not from the mind, like in the past with CSR. You cannot just copy a community of loyal customers who do marketing, sales, and service for you for free among each other for your company, or even do HR, crowdfunding, or innovation for you for free because you have a higher goal or purpose. That's not easy to copy. competition will be driven by soft factors going forward, not the hard factors, including banks and insurance companies, in my view. Think about the green finance, right? Great two previous talks. I fully agree. Right moves. It's about purpose. Green finance, right? More exponential technologies. It's all happening. Also, experimentation. I brought Lean Startup to Europe 5 years ago with the founder, Eric Ries. I'm also involved with design thinking, 10 years. Those innovation methods changed my life. I used to work with Prince 2, linear sequential product development or innovation steps. Doesn't work. And it's very political, not team building, team vibe. If you are innovating also in finance today, you have an idea, a concept, and the next day you can test it with real clients, customers, to see if you are on the right path in terms of your assumptions about the client profile, the client customer use case, the customer problem you are solving, and the customer solution that you are creating. So thinking, doing on a daily basis. A/B testing, experimenting. That's a key asset of an exponential organization. The costs of experimenting are today, in most cases, already lower than the costs of planning. Think about this. You can lower the cost of innovation and time involved by 50 to 75% in some cases using Lean Startup and or design thinking combined. And then we have autonomy, self-organizing teams making decisions. We move from hierarchies to teams as a key building block of organizations. I'm doing those transformations myself, well, after launching the book 2.5 years ago. It's very hard, but it's possible. From vertical to horizontal peer accountability, not vertical accountability. Less middle management. Why is this possible? We can do self-management by employees and teams. Why? Because they are passion and purpose driven. They are aligned with the purpose of the organization. So you don't need to micromanage them. They are intrinsically motivated. And they know the boundaries of the company based on the purpose and the legal boundaries, right? And the culture. We see companies, exponential organizations, that have one layer of management after 500 employees. I invite you to think, how many layers of management do you have when you have 500 employees inside your company today? Probably 4 to 5. So you save 3 to 4 layers of management, making you more agile and flexible. And this scales to 10,000 employees like Buurtzorg in Holland, without just teams, autonomous teams, making their own decisions. Sometimes even without a manager or project manager, all team members among themselves, including making all the staff functions and decisions in the team itself, procurement, IT, HR, what have you. All right, exponential organizations. 3 minutes left, some words on China. I love China. I wrote a book about China 20 years ago, 200 pages, changed my life. China is 2 times faster than Silicon Valley today, at least, 5x faster than Europe. If you don't go to China quite often, you become fragile and vulnerable. Not today, but in the next 5 to 10 years. It's all happening in China. Wuxi, Shenzhen, and Beijing. Especially Wuxi. Why is China winning? How come? A few reasons. First, China is about Confucianism and Taoism. Confucianism is about pragmatism. That means they believe in learning by doing, tinkering. We in Europe are way too academic and cognitive and, let's say, rational, academic. We think and talk too much. They just do. Technologies and whatever, they just start. I've seen it myself. I was with the Huawei in Shenzhen 2.5 years ago talking about my book. They liked the presentation, exponential organization. The next day, 150 people dedicated to implement all the concepts of the book. It's unbelievable. Where should we start? On the corporate BU level, blah, blah, blah. They just start. Okay. And in Europe, we talk for 2 years, at least, right? That's the difference. Okay. So Lean Startup and design thinking is also about tinkering, learning by doing, right? So we need to embrace that. Second, more importantly, China is about Guangxi relationships. We see the world atomized as individual objects and companies in competition terms. That's outdated. That works in a stable, simple environment with simple technologies. We live in a world of at least 100 different exponential technologies. In China, they understand we need to collaborate. So the CEO of Haier and the CEO of Alibaba and Foxconn, they are fully aligned. They work in an ecosystem of 150 companies working together as one company. More than in Europe. And in a world of singularity, meaning technological convergence, you need to collaborate to win, to compete. We are too much focused on competition, atomized worldview of companies, outdated. Not broad enough, deep enough in terms of competence and expertise and knowledge. China is also winning because of the CTO in China is mostly the CEO or political leader. In Europe, I've done a lot of research, most leaders in Europe in politics, media and business are alphas and gammas. That means economists like me, lawyers, right, politicians, whatever, not technologically educated, let's say, people, right? That's why China is winning. We move into a more technological world. That means we need to have a technological vision and roadmap and strategy. And they have a better sense of that because the CTO is the CEO in most cases, more than in Europe. And a similar is happening in Silicon Valley, by the way. The CTO is the CEO, increasingly. Make sense? Okay. Time's up. So I would like to close with my company. I started a year ago in New York, small pitch. We looked at, let's say, corporate transformation, let's say, in the classic ways to do it. We didn't buy it. So we reinvented all the building blocks of the business model of, let's say, classic consulting and trading approaches. And we have lowered the cost 10 to 20x to implement for corporate transformation. And the impact is higher, right? And the time is only 6 months. I can show you the cases. You can look it up by yourself. www.exoxo.co. Exoxo.co. So this is important because we believe we need to transform large organizations and even governmental institutions faster to help improve the world. We are in trouble, right, in many fields. So we need up the processes of corporate transformation. With that, I would like to close, and I thank you very much for your time and attention, and I wish you a great day, and thanks for having me.
So, thank you very much, Yuri. Just to give everyone 50 seconds to come back on Earth and on your feet after this presentation, just a quick question for you, and then we'll also look at the questions that have been sent through the app. But you know, when you take those examples like Abra, Lemonade, you're basically explaining that it's disrupting the entire environment. And for players like most of us here, we are these existing players that are being disrupted. So what's your view, Yuri? Do you think that players like ourselves have an opportunity to adjust, transform fast enough? Or do you think that these players ultimately will take over no matter what we do? And you talked about Allianz acquiring a stake in Lemonade, for example. But do you think that on our own, you know, we can actually compete against those new players that are appearing?
Yeah, it's possible, but most will fail. I think today around...
That's
honest, man. I talked to most CEOs globally like the last 2.5 years, also the largest organizations. And I think 10 to 20% has the courage to disrupt themselves internally in the core business, but more importantly, on the edges, to reinvent their products and services, and even their whole organization. I know about banks that are disrupting their whole organization using blockchain, right? Using Ripple or IPFS or even Polkadot. That's already happening. They are really bold, very bold and courageous. They will survive, in my view. Most are not able to do it because of shareholder value, short-termism, IRR pressure, right? Cultural inertia, there's no alignment in the C-suite and the board. You need full horizontal and vertical alignment between those two entities. If there's not full alignment, it won't happen, right? So there are many inhibitors to make this work, but there is a possibility. We work with some clients that are bold, and also in automotive, for example, one of the largest two companies in the world. They are making decisive moves. On the edges, small teams, disruptive small teams on the edges, reporting to the CEO, even chairman, for long-term backing for innovation, not the CFO or middle management. They use lean startup and design thinking as approaches, methods. Different teams competing against each other, full autonomous and independent, their own budget and mandate. They use learning and progress KPIs instead of financial short-term KPIs, so no DCF or IRR, EVA at first. Do you make progress? Every 5 weeks, we amplify the budget. Small budgets, right? Create a portfolio, you optimize it over time. Smart failures, or let's say fast failures are embraced, right? Instead of long-term investments. What is also important is to have a new kind of leadership, right? I talked to the number one management CEO in the world a few weeks ago. Maybe you know him, Marshall Goldsmith, amazing guy, by the way, a very authentic human being. He told me there's a shift happening in leadership in CEOs, right? From directing, right, top down, to enabling, facilitating, listening, asking questions, being open, being vulnerable, being authentic, really, and most importantly, being purpose-driven, right? Internally and externally, and building open ecosystems of innovation from the outside in. Your organization becomes a platform organization, open data, open APIs, open ecosystems. You collaborate with hackers and developers and startups and competitors and universities and maybe even governments to become the key platform in your business. And guess what? That's also outdated because my new book will be about platform of platforms. How can your company become the platform of platforms in your business using AI as a strategic platform layer on top of it? That's a key competitive game emerging now in most spaces. But also it's important to think about if you are innovating in your core business today, what happens? You will activate the immune system, it will create antibodies and kill your innovative idea, especially when it's a disruptive idea. And I have seen it myself. I worked for corporate 7 years. I was innovating in the core. That's why I'm a little bit bold, right? It was crazy. It happened once, but it's really tough. So you have to do it on the edges to make it work consistently long term. Also, I think a big mistake people make, or let's say most organizations, they think about disrupting themselves, but they have no clue what they will do if it becomes very successful, right? So for example, now you have Allianz and then you have Lemonade. Now Lemonade becomes very successful. It will have a short-term impact in terms of cash flow. You have a dip. Then the shareholders will complain, right? Rightly so. So you have to think about how you manage that proactively before you start with all those startups on the edges, right? Internally and externally. How do you deal with success? After 2 years, after 5 years, after 10 years. Our learning is an insight. Practical insight, you have to leave it alone for at least 5 to 10 years, not 2 years. Don't integrate it into your core business, because then you again will activate the immune system and it will create a bad environment for the entrepreneurial spirit of the startup and innovation. Make sense?
Okay. Makes sense. Thank you, Yuri. Maybe we can take one of those questions that was sent here. Let me read it to all of you. With computation power equivalent to the scale of the universe, don't we make all security existing totally obsolete, threatening all exchanges within our systems, economies, and the world?
Yes and no. Today, the answer is yes, in terms of classic blockchain platforms, right? They are not secure enough, even though there are many technical showstoppers, but they have been disrupted by quantum computing. But, as I said, it's possible to withstand the power of quantum computers using more advanced blockchain alternatives. I call it IPFS and Ripple and Jacu, G-A-C-C-O-O, is the number one transaction platform engine for blockchain in the world. You can look it up yourself. It's a company called Xi Fintech, QIFintech.com. It's all there. That's a safe, secure platform. So it's tough. This issue is a big issue, security issue, encryption issue, geopolitics, now you name it, right? Business implications. But it's solvable, so no worries. It will take 2 to 3 years to make it operational.
Thank you. Is there anyone who has a burning question in the audience?
By the way, I get connected to all these platforms as you want, because I know these founders and CEOs, okay?
David, you want to... Mike?
Yeah, I hear you.
If you were a millennial today, would you even study? Would you go into higher education? And if so, what would you do?
Love this question. All the questions, by the way, but especially this one. I have two kids. 10 years ago, my daughter was 4 years old back then. I thought, okay, because I knew about the singularity, of course, already. Okay, what is going to be key in terms of jobs? Alpha and beta. If you work in gamma, economists, lawyers, you are in trouble. Sorry about it. And right now, she is an expert in alpha and beta, so I'm really happy and satisfied. Why is this the case? A lot of new jobs in beta. Implementing, installing, and repairing and maintaining robots, drones, solar panels, solar nanocoatings, biotech, nanotech, what have you, right? A lot of space, jobs, tasks, growth there, obviously. Second, alpha, liberal arts. Why is that the case? The soft factors of our humanity. Technology is great in diagnostics, right? Analysis, blah, blah, blah. But it isn't good in your right brain skill sets. That means love, compassion, empathy, intercultural sensitivity, entrepreneurship, finding your own passion and purpose, intuition, moral jazz, wisdom, ethics, philosophy, history, computational thinking, systemic thinking. All these, let's say, soft factors become more important over time. There will be a huge amount of work and jobs in those spaces, including for our kids and educational adaptation, and also for the job market as well. Why is that the case? As I said, we have to dance with the machine, the best of both worlds. Man plus machine, best results. AI is better to anticipate the rational outcomes of things. But it doesn't have the emotional or conscious or flexible aspects of it. And we move from a world of information to intelligence to consciousness. Now, the intelligence you can outsource to artificial intelligence to a certain degree. But the consciousness part, the subjective part, the feeling part, the spiritual part, you cannot outsource to technology, right? Robots don't feel enchantment, or the robots don't cry yet, right? Probably ever, in my view, but I'm not certain about it, but I don't think robots will cry, right? We do. So crying becomes more important. So whatever you're going to do as HR or market CMO or CFO, whatever, your work becomes more human, more interesting. Why? More creative, more strategic, more human, right? More interesting, fascinating, less routine, less dull, less dirty, less dangerous. You can outsource that to technology increasingly, mostly AI. Make sense?
Thank you, Yuri. I think we're going to stop here. Sorry for those who asked further questions. You know, Yuri will
be
there
around,
so please catch up with him. Maybe as a conclusion on my side, Exponential Organization is the title of your book. So if you want to go faster than the Chinese, go on your iPhone, order it online, read it, and by tomorrow, implement it. So thank you very much, Yuri.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.